And today we're going to be talking about Richard Dyer and his star theory. So Richard Dyer is a professor in the Department of Film Studies at the King's College London. His star theory is all about stars, celebrities, and we're going to discuss it. So one of the first stage in kind of like star theory is considering stars as constructs. And according to Dyer, stars are not real people. They're constructed through media platforms and such as like the X Factor, you know, on television programs when you have those like reality TV shows where they find a winner, like X Factor on One Direction. Those people are stars beforehand, they aren't celebrities, aren't anyone knows. And they go onto these shows and people and the media build them up to be these people. They're not other people that they think the audience is going to want, they think the public is going to want. An example of this is One Direction, Little Mix, Leona Lewis, anyone who's really won a reality show like that, because they were normal people once and their image and everything does change because they're constructed, because they need to be, because the people they were before they went on these shows doesn't make them interesting enough in order for them to be a star, so they have to be constructed. Most stars will have a unique selling point, which, or a USP as I'll continue to call it, and the USP can be copied or produced in order to, it's kind of like, it's their brand basically. So you can see this through Lady Gaga and her wacky and crazy outfits, Elton John, and his glasses, Sia and her wig. All of these things can be parodied on like skit shows like SNL, Saturday Night Live, across talk shows and everything, and it's their selling point. That's always the thing you're going to know them for, and that is always constructed. There isn't necessarily something they will have, especially with Lady Gaga. Before she was famous, her name isn't really Lady Gaga. She never really wore these wacky outfits before she was famous. That came along as she became more famous, and she needed something to be known for, not just her music, but the way she dresses and acts on red carpets. She came in a massive egg to one of the red carpets and everything. And people continue to talk about these things. It keeps them in the public. It keeps them in the public eye and keeps people talking about them. Keeps their records selling. Pop stars, according to Richard Dyer, they have an advantage over film stars because they're constructed kind of like a persona, their USP. They can be more consistent over time because they're more in tune with what the people want. They see the people more often, whereas like film stars depend on the creativity of others. They have to get in line with like the director and the screenwriters and like casting and things like that, where pop stars only really have to rely on themselves and a few other key people around them, like their record label, whereas film stars have to wait for like things to be written and everything. So moving on forward to industry and audience, which is the second part of Richard Dyer's star theory. So according to Dyer, stars are commodities, they're products for us to spend money on. We buy records, we become fans of them, we buy their merchandise, and a star's taste and preferences, as their audience taste and preferences, will change, it will evolve. Because in order for them to keep making money, they need to keep making sure that what they're doing is in line with what their audience want them to do. So another good example of this is Taylor Swift. She went from doing country music, being a very country girl, wearing cowboy boots on the red carpet, these big like sparkly dresses. And now she is one, if not the most popular female pop artist in the whole world. She's gone from a country star to a pop artist because her audience was evolving. So she needed to evolve, not to just include country music, but to bring in a wider audience. So pop music is where she's ended up. And that has been hugely successful for her. She makes millions upon millions every year because she took that transition, because that's what her audience wanted her to do. She was listening to her audience. And people buy the products. They buy her pop albums more than they did her country albums. Miley Cyrus, she was this Disney star, this wonderful little Disney star that was great for teenagers and preteens and younger kids. But as Miley Cyrus grew older, her audience also grew older because they were growing up and moving on from Disney Channel, and she evolved as well, where she's gone from this Disney star to this hippie kind of like indie pop star who does a lot of charity work and everything. She's not afraid to be herself, and that really resonated with her audience as well. And she's making millions upon millions now as a pop star with her own weird wacky ways, which is great. Record labels have a tendency to manufacture what they believe that their audience wants to see. So again, going back to like talent shows, this is where you get it, where you see time and time again these same kind of like girl groups and boy groups, Little Mix with Harmony, One Direction, as I've already mentioned. You see these carbon copies of boy bands and girl bands, and even solo artists, although you tend to not hear as much from them after they've won shows like The Voice and The X Factor and Britain's Got Talent. And they're constructed to be as the showrunners think the audience wants. So Little Mix and Fifth Harmony, you put them together, they're almost exactly the same, but one's American and one's British. Their style is exactly the same, the sort of music they produce is exactly the same, and it's what the producers of the show and now their record labels think that children and teenagers want from a girl group. And the same with One Direction, really marketed towards girls as well, with and it's an all boys group, and you get the songs all about love and everything, because that's what's going to make them the most money. But however, there is an audience who doesn't like the carbon copy, sort of the alternative groups and stuff. So record labels will try and they'll try to find artists who also resonate with those people. So you'll get people, you have like the rock and indie bands and record labels and everything, because people don't want this carbon copy mainstream, but the record labels still want to be making money, and they still want their bands and people to be making money. So you do get like bands, Umit 6, All Time Low, Moose Blood, all of these other bands that aren't exactly completely popular and in the mainstream. They're different and they apply to another audience. So going on to ideology and culture, Dyer says that stars present certain ideologies or ways of thinking with the expectation that their followers and their audience will go along with this and believe this too. So again, with Lady Gaga, she puts across LGBTQ issues and puts them into the spotlight. Miley Cyrus also does this, and with homeless charities, she even set up her own foundation, the Happy Hippie Foundation. Beyonce spreads awareness for feminism and racism, and these are all issues that their audience all follow along with as well. They all want that to be sorted and stuff like that. So having Richard Dyer says that having ideologies and presenting them enhances a star's star quality and helps them to create a star persona. Because an audience isn't going to completely follow someone who has no ideologies. Fans and audiences want to know what's going on inside a star's head because they want to connect with them in some way. Because they are seen as these big people, they're not real people because they are stars, but these ideologies make them a real person, because they're like, oh, they have feelings and thoughts and they care about such and such situation, and an audience will latch on to that because it makes them more real, it enhances their star persona. Social networks like Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, they give stars a bigger platform on which to establish their values outside of music. Stars can keep fans constantly up to date every day and every week with like their favourite fashion trends or social issues, anything really, because of social media, and that keeps fans so intrigued and interested into what they're doing. Many stars have ideologies that include materialism and sexuality, and institutional support from magazines, TV shows and websites, And these all help create and devote themselves to star scrutiny, and it's made stardom and star worship a cultural value. So you're constantly finding magazines like OK Magazine, like tabloids online, and everything, that will be putting these stars in the public eye and their ideologies in the public eye, and that keeps fans interested all the time. It keeps them culturally aware, it keeps them in the public eye all the time. And our final one from Richard Dyer, stage 4, character and personality. Here Richard Dyer suggests that a music star exists as a real human, but there's a transformation process that takes place and layers them with characteristics and personalities to fit their branding. So Ed Sheeran was on his own, didn't have a record label. Then he got a record label and he was kind of known, oh, as this cheeky chap, he's got ginger hair. That was kind of, he's really nice and everything. He drastically changed, and his music drastically changed as well in order to fit kind of the mainstream. And then he also, you know, he didn't listen to his record label and things like that, and one of his albums didn't do as well as they thought it would. And then he went back, listened to his record label's ideas and everything, and made a new album, which is now widely successful again. And that really shows how a music star really has to depend and should listen to their record label if they want to be successful, because they are just constructs and they are given these characteristics and personalities in order to make them likeable, and in order to fit their brand. So a star provides an audience with ideas on how a person should be. So female stars like Ariana Grande, she shows women kind of like how they should be, and people like Selena Gomez, even Beyonce and everyone, they kind of put out this, they put out to women that they should be beautiful and thin, and they always should look a certain way and look great. And then there are people like boys like Justin Bieber, who kind of put out to the male side that they should be buff, they should be manly, and they really do kind of provide this kind of, they play into stereotypes of men and female and stuff like that. And audiences are constantly comparing themselves to these stars and believe that the stars are almost godlike, especially when you bring in, again, from ideology and culture, these tabloids and everything, because people devote their lives to stars sometimes, and stars exude such perfection that they cannot be attained in real life, which is quite sad, and people always try to obtain that. So basically what Richard Dyer is saying is stars are not real, and culture and society has built them up to be such amazing creatures that they're almost like gods that everyone needs to listen to, because they are the perfection, they are who you should want to be in life, regardless if it's not obtainable, regardless if they're not real people. And Richard Dyer, I think, has really hit the nail on the head with this. He's really gone into depth in how stars are constructed and how they have to be carefully constructed in order for an audience to like them.